about practical results and, of course, conclusion. Our motivation, why are we doing these things? Mainly, you can buy repeaters for 1 gigabit or 10 gigabit Ethernet or even for 10 gigabit packet over SONET if you want to extend the span length. What's more, we're trying to do it with what we call nothing in line or repeaterless solutions. Again, why nothing is in line? What does it mean? There is really nothing along your fiber. And why are we trying to do these things? Because sometimes, as you can see, there is fiber on the top of high voltage poles, which is a real example from Czech Republic. Sometimes it can be useful for coast island links. Of course, in Czech Republic, we have no islands, but other countries have. And sometimes this problem with power supplies and ease of maintenance, because definitely it's really nice to have all your equipment in one rack, maybe in some point of presence, and not in the middle of nowhere. Yes, it can happen even in Central Europe. So we're using optical amplifiers, EDFA and Raman technology, because it's a protocol and bit transparent. First, some remarks on numerical simulations. And just to estimate the maximum span length for 10 gigabit transmission for a single channel, you've got two main problems. Chromatic dispersion, you must compensate it. And the second problem is this, what we call surface modulation. I will talk about it later. Why 10 gigabit transmissions? Because for 1 gig and 2.5 gig, these effects are really negligible and you can forget them. Of course, it's nice to have bit error rate better than 10 to minus 12, or this is written in Q factor. You can use what you like, bit error rate or Q factor, which stands for quality factor. By the way, of course, basic problem is attenuation of the link, but it's so well known, and therefore it's really not interesting. Just to show what I'm talking about, chromatic dispersion. On this picture, you can see chromatic dispersion standard single mode fiber. The second picture shows you standard mode single mode fiber with compensation. And this dispersion is not only flattened, but is significantly lower for about 4 or 5 times. Surface modulation, it's a nonlinear phenomena. And again, just to show you, this is for a very low launched power in fiber, it was about 16 dBm. And with 1 watt launch into single mode fiber, you can see this pulse in frequency domain is in a flattened light balloon. Of course, it's bad thing. We used two schemes to compensate chromatic dispersion with our software. This is just transmitter, first booster, single mode fiber, which is our backbone line. The second amplifier, DCF, which stands for dispersion compensating fiber. Here you have optical filter just to beat noise. After that you have detector and electrical filter, which is standard part of the receiver, not standalone box. Here is post-compensation scheme, because DCF goes after standard CMF. And this is pre-compensation scheme, because you have amplifier, booster, DCF, preamp, and your backbone line. We used for simulation really high quality parameters for fibers and lasers, so you can expect some problems with real components. Of course, better is a post-compensation scheme due to problems with these high power booster and DCF, because DCF fiber, you can expect some strong effects of surface modulation. Just to show you, first, you should optimize DCR, which stands for dispersion compensation ratio. And here you can find this is the best DCR is about 0.8. This is Q factor, which is better than 7. And this is parameters are input power in a standard single mode fiber. What does it mean? It means you can compensate only 80% of dispersion. Means dispersion is not compensated down to zero, but some residual dispersion is left for about 20%. This is the same picture with DCR. So you can see standard single mode input power, and you can see some maps of Q factors. Maybe it can be better for understanding. After that, you could try to optimize input powers into SMF and DCF. Again, we have this DCF input power, bit error rate, and the best is this red curve, which stands for 19 dBm. On the second picture, again, you can see single mode input power in SMF and input power in DCF, and again, something like map of bit error rate, and you can see even bit error rate 10 to minus 20, which you can't measure it. It takes a lot of time. Just to show you some experimental results from our simulation, this is for this scenario 270 kilometers of SMF with 45 kilometers of DCF. This is your signal just after SMF, it means the output of your backbone line. Here you have output after DCF, after compensation. Here you have the output of optical filter just to improve signal to noise ratio. And here you can see the nice ones and zeros after electrical filter. As I said, these electrical filters are just part of the receivers. The last picture, what is called eye diagram. This is superposition for all bitter patterns, all zeros and ones, and you can see it looks very good with Q factor better than 7. And we found the maximum from theory is 270 kilometers, and you can overcome with our nothing inline solutions. As Viktor said, our session is called about practical results. So I'm going to present our result with 1 gig, 2.5 and 10 gigabit Ethernet, again with nothing inline solutions. We tested three different configurations with optical amplifiers, EDFA and Raman. We used really fiber field test beds, it means cables laid in ground. Just to show you, we started with our experiments, I think back in 2002, and as a result, 2 gig gigabit Ethernet backbone lines are currently used in CESNET 2 network. Again, with nothing in line solutions. Equipment used, most important Cisco Catalyst with 1 port 10 gigabit Ethernet card, GSR for packet over SONET testing, and Kiopsis high power boosters and low noise amplifiers. As you can see, it's truly multi-vendor environment. Just to show you our scenarios, I'm going to talk about only 10 gigabit scenarios. You have booster, fiber loop, again your backbone line, dispersion compensating fiber, and the second router. It was only for one direction. The second direction was optical shortened using only patch cord, because we have only one fiber loops and optical amplifiers for one direction. Scenario number two, booster and preamplifier. You have router, booster, standard fiber, preamplifier, DCF, optical filter to improve optical signal to noise ratio, and of course router. For 1 gig and 2.5 gig, you can leave out DCF and optical filter. Oh. Scenario number three, you have booster, preamplifier with DCF and optical filter, and here is Raman pump, which is this fiber is pumped via this box called a circulator. For packet over SONET testing, we had only one line card, so we used this as in looped regime, just once with booster fiber loop. It was just only 1 port. So you can expect some problems, as I was talking about. This serial equipment is not DWDM lasers, and you can expect some problem with chair applied with and modulators, things like that. The second problem was with field test beds. It's real cables with a lot of patch cords. Another problem was we have a lot of patch cords between our lab and ODF, ODF where these loops are terminated. So you should recalculate this length to more realistic figures. We found it's really average attenuation of our length. It's about 0.27 dB per kilometers. Practical result. For 1 gig and 2.5 gig, of course, 1 gigabit Ethernet needs not truly multi-gigabit speed. Anyway, we were able to go up to 200 kilometers with booster and preamp, with no compensation, no filter. Estimated length for real backbone line is about 220 kilometers. After that, we were trying to do 200 kilometers and 25, again with this configuration booster and preamp. We used optical filter, but we were successful only with short packets, the same principle as is used in X25. It was for really short packets, it was dropouts about 0.4%. For 10.5 gigabit, we were able to cover 200 kilometers again with no compensation and no filter. But when we try to do it with 225 kilometers, we used even optical filter to improve signal-to-noise ratio, but unfortunately something went wrong. Maybe even for these distances, even for 2.5 gig, some form of compensation is needed. What is really important, and we focused on results on 10 gigabit Ethernet. Oh, here we have 100 kilometers with booster only scenario, even with no compensation, without optical filter, with estimated length 125 kilometers. We were really surprised we can do that with no compensation. It's a really interesting point. After that, we were trying loops with 150 kilometers, again with this booster and preamp scenario. Of course, for this length is dispersion so high, and of course you must compensate it. And of course, optical filter is mandatory because it's really noisy. Again, results were okay. After that, we were trying to cover 200 kilometers with additional of Raman pump. Of course, with compensation and with optical filters, but unfortunately, I think this Raman pump was not designed to long-haul transmission, and again, you need very powerful amplifiers to cover so long distances. But anyway, I think these numbers, it's for sure 100 kilometers and 150 kilometers, are well beyond 40 kilometers as specified in specifications for 10 gig Ethernet. So I think it's really interesting. I think some of you can expect some problems, part number two, with bit error rate measurement. Because we had no proper equipment, we rely on ping testing, which is not so bad, because packet over SONET line cards, you can check BIP counters, just to check what's going on the fiber. And if it's okay for 2.5 gig, it must be okay for 1 gigabit. So we really believe for our simulation and this results because two backbone lines are in operational for about 1 year and they are without any problems. For 10 gigabit Ethernet, situation is really difficult because testing equipment is pretty expensive, but we still believe in our simulations and the results of our ping testing. What does it mean? When you have billions of long packets with zero dropouts and without any problems like lost carrier and strength conditions you can check for on the router, we really believe we have no problems. Just some remarks on DWDM systems testing. We try to use single channel EDFA with DWDM systems, only with up to 8 lambdas. We tested 3 DWDM platforms, Cisco together with the EDFA and Pandatel, which is Germany company, and of course our Keopsis optical amplifiers. Keopsis is French company. just to show you some, it was tested on a real production line with lengths of about 130 kilometers. So here you can see some interesting pictures, spectral diagrams. When you really boost this fiber with 30 dBm input power just after EDFA and just before receiver. And you can see for DWDM system, this is really a problem with nonlinear effects. You can see even new channels here. And you can see, of course, these data channels and optical service channel were really badly affected. And for 30 dBm, data traffic was corrupted. Means with DWDM, you have not only problem with self-phase modulation, but with cross-phase modulation and fourth-wave mixing. Optical service channel was mostly affected, so these boxes couldn't communicate with each other. But we found that single channels, EDFAs, were really okay for five channels. And with this point, for 16 or 32 channels, which is this box capable, you need really powerful booster to overcome even 100 kilometers. Because for EDFA or Raman, this energy or power is distributed among all wavelengths. And what is 17 dBm for one channel? Because 17 dBm is a Cisco EDFA. It's approximately 2 dBm per one channel if you use 32 channels. So it's really nothing, because 2 dBm is just normal output power for normal line card you can buy in your routers. So some conclusions. We presented nothing in line solutions for multi-gigabit links in our CESNET 2 gigabit networks. What we would like to improve, this is written in here, better fibers. It means we would like to get rid of a lot of patch cords and cables and things like that. We would like to improve our equipment. It means we could use really low noise amplifiers, EDFA or Raman, and if possible to use DWDM lasers, which are really good and you can expect good performance. Maybe one interesting point is here, more precise compensation, not only with dispersion compensating fiber, but with this another technology which stands for fiber break ratings. We would like to improve our performance with this type of compensation. And of course, maybe most important, we would like to improve our bit error rate measurements, and even with eye mask testing with broadband oscilloscopes. Acknowledgements to our colleagues from CESNET for their cooperation and help. Some references here, you can find something about our nothing inline solution in production network, some good books on this topic. And if I forget anything, I think it's too late. Thank you for your kind attention.
Time for a few questions. So,
if not, then yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Good. Yeah, there's somebody else.
I presume you use the 10 gigabit Ethernet LAN PHY or the WAN PHY for the interface.
So I think for a Cisco equipment, it's LAN PHY.
LAN PHY.
Yes.
Okay. It's so sure. Maybe if you use the WAN PHY, the wide area network, then you can use bit interleaved parity counters.
Yes, we have tested only two LAN cards, and of course it's only one vendor, and I think you can expect not the diametral, but some problems maybe with different vendor and different equipment. But I don't think so, because we tested a lot of 1 gigabit interfaces, and all of them were capable doing this.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but what you said that you missed the capability of measuring bit error rate, that might be possible with the other type of interface.
Yes. Exactly.
There's another one. Yeah, David.
Thanks. Just to try and summarize, so 2.5 gig, you can drive 200 kilometers, 10 gig, you can drive 100 kilometers, yeah?
No, exactly. You can drive up to, it depends on the scenario used, if it's only booster or booster and preamp. Mm-hmm. I think you can drive up to 150 kilometers for 10 gig and 220 kilometers for 2.5 gig.
No.
So SMF 28.
Sorry?
SMF 28.5.
Yes, yes.
And are you planning to work on, are you interested in improving these distances or?
Yes, definitely. You would like to try another equipment? Yes. You can ask my colleagues. They are very willing to answer.
I would like to stress that the attenuation of these lines, which are available at CESNET, are really very high. So when we assumed in these simulations a reasonable value of attenuation like 0.22 dB per kilometer, we could really reach these 270 kilometers without any problems. Unfortunately, the lines which are available have the average value of 0.27 dB per kilometer.
Yes, of course, because you always have some patch cords. You cannot splice directly, connect to routers directly. Yes, maybe it's average value. It can be better or it can be worse.
Okay, I want to thank you again. Just one remark before that. I think that it's a very valid testing what you're doing, and I hope there are some vendors or equipment providers around here who would invest to provide, for instance, bit error rate equipment or interfaces, just to see if it is indeed reproducible and so on. Thanks again, John.